will be meeting each Saturday upstairs in the right now entitled Early Team Room, but it's under construction to a degree. Sack cool, be here.
A new time for the gathering, annual Sabbath, 9:30 a.m. here in the sanctuary.
We are so excited as a church to participate in a Red Cross blood drive. It will be held here in the Vine Center starting at 10 a.m. on December 8th. It is a great opportunity to truly provide life to our community.
Church Born, December 7th, here in the church.
Anytime you want.
Redwood Adventist Christmas. Do it again.
All right, go ahead.
Take two. Redwood Adventist Academy Christmas Program, December 11th, right here in the sanctuary. Be here.
Hey, have you made it to Vespers yet? The next one's going to be on December the 17th, right here in the sanctuary at 7 p.m. Thanks so much for being here. Let's praise Jesus. Well, happy Sabbath, everyone. I'd like to invite everybody who's kind of standing around to come forward and have a seat. Oh, it's such a beautiful Sabbath this morning. Let's celebrate and bring praises to our God. Can I have you stand, please? Let's sing together.
Welcome, everyone. I'm constantly reminded that, in fact, I think this last song, Give Thanks, is so appropriate for the season now. This week, not just a week, are we truly giving thanks all the time? I hope so. I need to do a better job of that, but I really am thankful, despite all the muck that could be in our lives. I'm so thankful. God's been good, really, really, really good. And I just wanted to welcome you here. Beautiful sunny Sabbath day. One of the things I think that we haven't seen in quite some time is the greenness that's all around us. And while we're thankful, at the same time I'm praying, send more, send more. I just want to take a moment, if you all want to stand up, and just kind of greet each other with a thankful heart and attitude. And there's someone you don't recognize, don't pass them up, okay? So let's greet each other.
So, we'll see. Valley. Let me try one more time.
Okay, let me see.
Okay, one more time. Good morning, church family.
Good morning.
Our scripture reading this morning is found in Luke chapter 10, verses 27 to 30, and I'm reading from the NIV. He answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength, and love all and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." "You have answered correctly," Jesus replied. "Do this and you will live." But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" In reply, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead."
Okay, I'd ask that you all get in a comfortable position of prayer and join me. Dear Heavenly Father, we humbly come to you this morning. We thank you that we can be here in the Sabbath to worship you and to worship you together. We ask that you bless those who could not be here this morning, that you be with them and be with each and one of everybody's family members. And as we go through the holiday season, it's important that we remember to praise you. And it's also important to think of those who have less, or who are needy, or are wanting, or hurting, who have needs. And we are often, it's easy for us to remember to love and praise you. We also need to be reminded to care about those around us and to remember those who have less. Oftentimes, it's not just a matter of giving, but oftentimes it's just a matter of giving a word of praise or encouragement. Sometimes that can make a big difference. So as we go into holiday season, please help us to remember those who are less needy, and sometimes just a word of encouragement that sometimes all the people need. We ask that you be with Pastor Brad as he delves into the word and delivers the message that you have for us, that you bless him and you bless us and help us to use the words that you're going to give to us and the message you want us to receive and how we can bless those around us. We ask that you be with us and hear and give the message we need here. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Children, it's time for a children's story, and so you can come up to the front, and while you're coming up, I already see one adult waving money at me. I was hoping, no, there are some adults who will wave money at you, and whenever somebody waves money at you, you should always take it. That offering is going to children's ministries. But I also want to invite the deacons and servers to come forward at this time and to collect our normal offering. For those of you that looked in your bulletin for strange things that Keith Francis put in there, you should find a little green insert which explains briefly what happens to your offerings. Here's the envelope, I'm hoping, and Carmen's hoping too, because she looked at me. This is the envelope that you should put your offerings in. Why? Because if you leave your offering loose, then it goes to whatever the cause is for that week. That just so happens that this week is the local church budget, so it will go to the budget. But last week, as you'll see on my little insert, it was for the world budget, and so if you put an offering in the plate thinking it's going to be used for the local church, you were wrong, because it was not. All right, you remember me a couple of weeks ago talking about intentional giving? I really want to stress this idea that we show how God has blessed us, not just by giving, which of course I assume you will all do, but we say what we want done with that money. So, children's ministries, children are collecting at the moment, and the deacons are coming now, or in a few moments, and they are going to collect an offering, and this is what you need to put it in. Please do that. Thank you.
We were there with my family, and we were camping out for several days. And early one morning, I got out of the tent to start working on breakfast, and I noticed that there were chipmunks everywhere. Have you guys seen chipmunks before? They're sort of like squirrels, but tinier. And so I was shooing them away to make sure that they weren't getting into our breakfast food. And I started preparing breakfast, and I saw a chipmunk start to sneak over to try to get at the food. And so I had a little rock by my table, and I tossed the rock at it to chase it away. And an accident happened. I bonked the chipmunk. And it did not look like it was doing well. So I decided that I was going to do the nice thing, and I was going to help it not hurt anymore. So I walked up to the chipmunk, and I bonked it with my knife so it wouldn't hurt anymore. And then I heard a still, small voice say, "Hey, again." And I thought, "Lord, no!" But then I turned, and behind me was my son, Lincoln, who is 3 years old. And he was standing next to me saying, "Hey, again." I know. Sometimes we have thoughts in our heads that come and they aren't very nice. They might involve bonking someone or saying something that's not very nice. We call those temptations. And they're the things that we think about, sometimes even that we do, that aren't very nice. But sometimes there are thoughts in our head that are nice. There are things that we do that are kind or loving. And one of the things that we learn as Christians is how to listen to that kind voice. That's the voice of God. That the Bible says that my sheep, Jesus tells us, my sheep, my followers, know my voice. And we can learn what that voice sounds like. We can learn how to listen to that kind voice in our heads.
by reading God's word, reading Jesus' word, because that helps us understand how Jesus speaks to us. That's why when we are in Sabbath school, we learn memory verses and cranky pastors talk about the Bible and all kinds of things, because we're learning to listen to the kind voice of Jesus in our lives. Let's start by praying and asking God to help us learn the voice of Jesus. Dear Jesus, thank you for speaking to us. We pray that you would help us to learn the sound of your voice that leads us to kindness and love for others. Amen. Thank you for listening to my story. Happy Sabbath. Welcome to the Santa Rosa Seventh-day Adventist Church. I have a good friend, Blake, I want to tell you about. He's one of my old college roommates. He's a pastor in Australia now. His family came to visit us when we were living in North Dakota. And so they were doing some driving, and so we let them borrow one of our cars. And they took off late at night. To be honest, I don't even remember where they were going in North Dakota. And early the next morning, I got a call from Blake. Man, you would not believe what happened last night. What happened? He said, well, about 100 miles from anywhere, which is 1,000 miles from everywhere, we got a flat in the middle of the North Dakota prairie. It was 2:00 in the morning. Oh man, I'm so sorry. That was exactly how I planned it, because I knew we needed new tires, but I'm so sorry. And he said, we stopped. We didn't know what to do. We didn't have cell phone service. And so here we are on the side of the freeway, me and our two kids and his wife. And so we began to pray. And after a few minutes, we heard this loud revving. And he said, it's huge Harley pulled up behind us, and this guy got off his bike. He was wearing nothing but like leather pants and a leather vest, and he had tattoos, more tattoos than skin, and a piercing everywhere you could imagine. And he said, we were freaking out. And the guy got off the bike and came storming over, and he just started cussing. And I was like, are you calling me because you're asking for ransom? What's happening? And he said, but as he did so, he just hopped under the car. He grabbed the jack. We had no idea what we were doing. And he cussing away, pumped. Jacked up the car, changed the tire, got the spare on, and within 10 minutes, we were back on the road. What? I was thinking about that story when I get into the book of Luke. And if you have a Bible with you, I want to invite you to open up your Bible to the book of Luke, chapter 10. We are processing together as a church. Actually, I've forgotten something. Mary Lou is sitting in the front row. Saying, Brad, hello, Brad, Brad, hi, hello, I'm still here. So 5 Luke chapter 10, and Mary Lou has a really special announcement for us as the home and school leader at Redwood Adventist Academy.
And all of us who came and bought our veggie burgers, we were able to raise over $500 at the Fall Festival. And then we had extras, and we were able to a hot lunch at school and raise another $300. So that helps a lot. All this money is going to various things that are outside of the budget at Redwood, like playground equipment. But the biggest thing right now that we're needing is choir risers for the music department. And each choir riser is over $1,700 before shipping and tax. And we need two minimum, but we prefer three of them. So that's what we're raising money for right now. And if you would mind putting it up on the screen, we're doing a Seize Candy fundraiser right now. And you can get access to the link to that fundraiser on the We Love Redwood website and go to homeschool link. And there's a link, you can't really see it very well, sorry, but the Seize Candy fundraiser link on that screen. And this is where we're going to post all of our fundraisers going forward so that you can see whatever we're doing. Also, if you don't want Seize Candy, which I know some of you don't really like chocolate, we always take donations towards home and school, and it goes to various fundraising activities and teacher appreciation and things like that. If you have any questions, my email address is also on the link through the website. The deacons are handing out a flyer for the fundraiser and with my email address on there. Thank you.
Thank you. What a great opportunity that is to continue to support Redwood, which is, of course, one of our key ministries here for our church, providing quality education as well as a spiritual campus for the young people of our community to develop their mind, their hearts, their physical gifts, and so forth. So, you're with me. Tattooed guy, highway, fixing the tire. You're in Luke chapter 10. We are studying together as a church, processing together, really, this mission, this identity of knowing God intimately, loving each other selflessly, and sharing the good news boldly. Last week, we talked about what it meant to know God intimately. That we begin with Jesus, and Jesus introduces us in so many ways to who God really is. This week we're considering that second piece of love each other selflessly. And conveniently enough, there's a beautiful story accompanying this second of the two great commandments that are really one. Love your neighbor as yourself. It's found in today's verse, Luke chapter 10. I'm going to begin in verse 25. And behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What is written in the law? How do you read it?" And he answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You have answered correctly. Do this, and you will live." But he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers, who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead." I want to stop here as we consider God's word. So if you were traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho, you had about a half day or so journey down out of Jerusalem, which is sort of up in the mountains outside of the Jordan River Valley, to Jericho, which was down near the Jordan River in the valley. And there is this incredibly sort of rocky terrain. The road follows. There are all kinds of these outcroppings and places for hiding, both people that are up to no good as well as the results of their up to no goodness. And this is a absolutely sort of notorious area for criminal activity in the days of Jesus. And this man, he falls amongst robbers, and strip him and beat him and leave him half dead. Now, by chance, a priest was going down that road. And when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. I am here today, among other things, because I love this passage, and I think probably some of you have heard me talk about it before. But I'm here, among other things, to advocate for some understanding for that priest. Because I don't know about you, but there are times in my life where I have been in dangerous situations. I remember one time I was driving through Oakland on the way home from a Warriors game. I got lost in downtown Oakland at about midnight. And I was scared. And I would like to tell you that I don't care who I would have seen on the ground next to my vehicle in downtown Oakland, but I would have had some real questions about getting out of my car to help them. Just being honest. I mean, this priest is in a notoriously dangerous area. He sees someone who has clearly just been attacked and left for dead. I'm thinking there are days, there are probably a lot of days where, like that priest, I'm getting out of there. He might already be dead for all he knows, and he's just putting himself at risk of becoming another victim. And the priest had good reasons to move along quickly. The priest had more than just some reasons regarding his physical health. If that man is dead, and because that man is naked, if he touches him, he can no longer perform his religious duties. Part of the rules for the priesthood that around sort of the rituals of religion for the Jews regarded being ceremonially clean. And there was sort of this vast category for the Jews of how one might become ceremonially unclean and therefore not able to participate in the important religious ceremonies for the Jews. And for the priest who is orchestrating those ceremonies, being unclean was a big deal. That means when someone travels to the temple to make an offering to receive forgiveness for their sins, the priest can't do it. And he actually had good religious reasons not to touch him. He might be thinking, hey, I have an important work to do for God. And if I touch this man, if I help this man, I am putting aside this important work. I think the priest had reasons. The story continues. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. And the Levite let the priest. He has good reasons. He should be worried for his personal safety. Like the priest, that the Levite has important religious duties, that if he should become ceremonially unclean, he would no longer be able to provide the function. So it is frankly understandable that they would go. And I would argue to you this morning that this story has less to do with being a referendum on the activities of the priest and the Levite, and it has everything to do with an elevation of the character that is about to enter the scene. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was. I want you to imagine the scene that Jesus is within. He is in the midst of this theological discourse. There is a lawyer of the religious law and apparently a crowd of Jews around him. They are having this in-depth discussion about the law and what is most important, what is greatest. And Jesus, when he introduces this character, then a Samaritan came along. There would have been an audible gasp in the crowd. No, not a Samaritan. Because for the Jews listening to this story, their first thought was, this guy is going to finish the job. Because the Samaritans were despised. They were, to quote the Grinch here as we enter the holiday season, loathed entirely. They hated each other, did the Samaritans and the Jews. At one point, John, the beloved disciple, comes to Jesus straight-faced after a Samaritan village asks him not to enter and says, Lord, would it be okay if I called down fire on the whole village? Like, that was the perspective. There are times when, like the tax collectors, Samaritans sort of got their own category of wickedness. It was like Jesus, he's with sinners and Samaritans. Samaritans were, in Jesus' day, essentially an ethnic religious group that were cousins to the Jews. They were more or less Jews who had intermingled with Gentiles and become sort of this ethnically more diverse population. I didn't know this until yesterday. I was doing some research on the Samaritans, and you can find Samaritans to this day. There are small groups of Samaritans that worship after the Samaritan way around the globe. Not a lot, I gather, but still. And the animosity between these two parties was huge, and it was exacerbated by the fact that they lived in close quarters. If you wanted to go to different parts of Judea, you passed through parts of Samaria, and vice versa. They hated each other, they were next to each other, and there was this long history of violence and aggression. They were, the Samaritans would do something to the Jews would do Samaritans. It was a mess. Jesus enters this Samaritan into the scene, and it is a culturally weighty character. And everybody in that room knows what's going to happen. And so I need us to imagine together that when Jesus said, he had compassion, it would have been a stunning thing. Even if this story happens to be made up entirely, it would still be a stunning thing for a Jewish rabbi to speak well of a Samaritan. He had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine, then set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when you come back, when I come back. Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among robbers? This lawyer who can't even say the name of the man, can't even call him the Samaritan, says, the one who showed him mercy. Jesus said to him, you go and do likewise. The Samaritan is meant to be what we focus upon in this story. The Samaritan is the one lost in the middle of Oakland who got out of his car to help the victim of a violent crime. Because don't mistake it for anything other than that he set him up on his own animal. That was his security. That was his safety. He sees some people coming out of the rocks and he is off. And he's going to outrun them. And not only does he get off of his place of safety
help this man, who, by the way, he very clearly knows is his enemy. There's no doubt for this Samaritan that he is helping a Jew. How do we know that? Because Jesus went out of his way to say that how many clothes did the man have on? None. His connection to his people was literally written all over, if you will, his skin. Well, figuratively, not literally. He would have been circumcised. He knows good and well this is a Jew he's helping. But he gets off of his animal, and then notice what he does. He doesn't even get on the animal. He puts the man on his animal. Should the worst happen, he has put himself in the position of getting that man to safety and him not. He bands up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. He's investing in this man. He brings him to the inn and gives him 2 denarii. That's a denarii is 1 day's wage. So, you know, if put that number wherever you want to in your own head, but 2 days' wages. And tells the innkeeper, don't hold anything back. Don't try to make this stretch. Give him whatever he needs. I will settle up with you. This is just a down payment. Just make sure he's provided for you. And the Samaritan so greatly sacrifices of himself to serve this man. Every step of the way. From just his cultural perspective, he is sacrificing. From a political and a religious perspective, he is sacrificing to help this man. He is sacrificing his own safety. He is sacrificing his own money. He is sacrificing, frankly, his own social standing, because he goes to an inn, this public place, to support a Jew. That word is getting around. Jesus is helping, to be honest. And how's that going to play when he gets back home? You did what? For who? I mean, this is top to bottom, is an act of sacrifice for the Samaritan. Jesus is direct, he's clear. You go and do likewise. This sense of Jesus, what it means to love your neighbor, is very, very clear. Jesus puts it another way in John chapter 15. He says, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friend. When we use the word love as Christians, it is significant. It is potent. It sort of sounds blasé to say, hey, you know what, at Santa Rosa STA, we're committed to loving each other selflessly. That's in our language today, that is something that comes off a bit blasé, right? Because we love everything. Fill in the blanks. Name a team that has ever played in the Bay Area, and I probably said, oh man, I love the... Name a food. Thanksgiving is coming. I will tell you all about how much I love literally anything set before me or within arm's reach. But the story of the Good Samaritan is meant to call our attention to how potent the call, the activity of love really is in Scripture. Love does not just, according to God's word, require sacrifice. Love is sacrifice. That's what it is. It isn't this sort of one-way street of, I love ice cream, and ice cream is really doing all the weight pulling in that relationship. Biblically speaking, when I say I love something, I am saying I am committed to laying down my life and sacrificing everything about who I am, what I am, in order to serve that. That's a lot. That's big. And I need us, we need to grapple with how vast that is. Jesus really puts it clear that you love one another as I have loved you. We so often think about the sacrifice of Jesus, and I'm going to use this language, we limit it to the cross. As if the sacrifice of Jesus took place over a single weekend. But what we need to understand is his every breath was sacrifice. As we approach the Christmas holidays, understand we are celebrating that Jesus gave up heaven in order to be a baby. That's sacrifice. He put on diapers for me. That's sacrifice. With every meal he ate, that was a sacrifice. He could be feasting in heaven. Every cold he had, the moments where he was cold and uncomfortable, I mean, he should have been in heaven. He should have been surrounded by angels declaring his greatness. He should have been being celebrated every single moment, and yet he was here. And it was daily, moment by moment, an act of sacrifice. Love is sacrifice. When we at Santa Rosa SDA are saying we choose to, we are determined to love each other selflessly, we are saying we have decided to sacrifice for one another. We have decided to sacrifice for the community that we exist in. That there is nothing we hold so dear that we would not give it up in order to step into the life of someone who is experiencing suffering. If I may be bold, that is all inclusive. I am saying that my political beliefs are at the altar if it means I can serve someone. That I am saying that my financial needs are at the altar. That my spiritual needs are at the altar. That my physical and emotional and mental needs are at the altar. And the only reason that makes sense is because we believe Jesus did the same thing for us. The only way that makes sense is if I begin to believe that there are people around me who are willing to do that for me. This love stuff is no joke. It is fundamentally risky. Sacrifice, of course, is. We are starting at that level. A determination to sacrifice for our neighbor. Because really, sacrifice and being selfless, those are one and the same. But that everything that comes before that must also be true, must also be in line. Because if I'm willing to sacrifice with you, then I'm willing to eat with you. If I'm willing to sacrifice for you, I'm willing to have a conversation with you. you. I'm willing to make sure that when you come to this place, you're not alone. If I'm willing to sacrifice for you, I'm willing to serve you. I'm willing to worship with you. I'm willing to enter your home or invite you into mine. I mean, who could possibly believe that we would be willing to sacrifice for them if we aren't willing to open our doors to them, physically and proverbially? As we process what it really means to love each other selflessly, to know God intimately, we're doing that together. And so I want to just call your attention to the back. Jim is next to the table. Jim, hi. There's a canvas back there. There's a couple canvases back there. And I want to invite you to take a moment after the church service today. And there's some permanent markers. And just write what it means for you to know God intimately. Today, what it means to you to love each other selflessly. Maybe that's a word, maybe that's a text of scripture, maybe that is an activity, but put it down. We want to consider that together, because that love, that knowing of God is so broad, it's something, there are things we can only do as a community. I won't get there by myself. I'm not going to sit in my office, sit in the car, sit at home, and figure out how to know God intimately. It is something that takes a church coming together, empowered by the Holy Spirit. And that's what we are starting. And where we will go, Lord only knows. Let us pray together, Lord. We are so incredibly grateful, Jesus, for your life of sacrifice on our behalf. A sacrifice to an extent that we struggle to wrap our minds around. But Lord, we as a church are just inviting your inspiration to be upon us collectively. That you would help us to pursue this unbelievable height of love, recklessly and endlessly sacrificially. It is simply what you have done. Thank you, in Jesus' name. Amen. Happy Sabbath, everybody.